I gave her an offer of what was in my bank account.
$7.38.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't much over that.
Every week for 10,000 weeks.
This is the Mark Howley Show. The Mark Howley
Show. Where I ask my guests, how did you do it and why? Mark
Howley Show. Hey, so welcome back. It's another Friday, and this is the Mark Howley Show. And thanks to anybody out there listening. Today, I have two guys that I've watched perform through their careers and just admired them. Rather than I saying who they are and all that sort of stuff, let me just, you want each one of you guys just introduce yourselves.
My name is Macky McNish, partner, co-partners with Matt at Middle Fork Roasters, and recently Marge Granola.
Woo!
Yeah, I'm Matt Parrish, and co-founder of Middle Fork Roasters with Macky, and kind of in charge of roasting and operations.
Now, let me think back on this thing. It has to be about 20, not maybe not quite, but close to 20 years ago when I think I met you, Macky. And I think the thing, I love the name, Macky McNish. I remember hearing that. Well, being an Irish guy from Philly, I'm like, oh, I got to go meet this guy.
Yeah.
If there's a Macky McNish rolling around, I got to get on him. So anyway, so then I met you. And I thought you were going to be like red hair with freckles.
Far from it.
Far from it, yeah.
He's Scottish Filipino.
Yeah, I know. So my family, like, we're all Pennsylvania on my dad's side. Scotch, grandfather, Irish, grandmother. So, yeah.
And then Filipino.
Yeah, my mom's side. I got all her traits, 100%,
oh, cool.
Obviously.
Cool. I think that's I think it's a cool mix. I had a good friend of mine who was German and Philippine. You know, and they went from some of them were pretty light skinned, some of them were darker skinned, but it's a cool thing. You know, I'm just Irish. We're just pale, white pale. That's it. We have chalk. I like to call it just chalk.
Yeah.
But anyway, so tell me a little bit now about, you guys have some history in coffee, but you know, how did you collectively get into coffee? So if you don't mind, I'm going to direct the question to Matt first.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so coffee's kind of been in my family for a really long time. My mom's a coffee roaster, so I've grown up around a coffee roasting machine. I've been, you know, been around my mom and her passion for coffee for a really long time. So it was something that was a part of our family, and I grew up and was around. Truthfully, my passion for coffee didn't really actually happen until after I graduated college. And I think it's one of those things. Anything your parents do is kind of uncool when you're a teenager.
Yeah.
And so it wasn't really until after I graduated college and I started working in her shop that I really, like, the romantic side of coffee hit me. And it was like, growing up here in the Pacific Northwest, we're surrounded. We constantly hear about this coffee culture
that we have out here.
I do. And, you know, growing up here, you hear that. But when I finally started working in the shop and seeing what she was doing and that her cafe was the centerpiece of the neighborhood. It was a gathering spot for people. It was something that brought community together. That really, like I said, it was romantic to me. And so that's where I really kind of started falling in love with it. You know, prior to coffee, our relationship really begins with when I met Macky. And that's kind of like...
Was that up at Western Washington?
That was up in Western Washington, up in Bellingham. And that's really where Macky and I like to say our story begins.
Okay.
Because we say this all the time. We're actually entrepreneurs first and coffee roasters second. And so our story begins with our passion for entrepreneurship. And my passion for entrepreneurship comes from Macky.
So Mackie's the brains behind the operations. What we're saying,
here. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
At least one of them are smart,
yeah, right? One of them
that.
Has
I
to be, yeah,
that.
Yeah. If you're gonna have a partnership, make sure one of them's smart. That's right. For sure.
Let me interject here for a minute. Your mother had, is it Victor's Cafe?
Victor's Cafe over in Redmond, yeah,
yeah, yeah. For anybody who doesn't know the area, Redmond is a town just outside of Seattle. As a person who moved from Philadelphia out to the Seattle area,
yeah,
probably one of the places that caught my eye when I came here, and it wasn't so much that was as much coffee as Redmond is a suburban part of Seattle, and it has a nice little community feel to it. And when you come into the town from north of it, and again, it's not like this big highway coming in, it's a 2-4-lane road, and you see this place, Victor's, and it's right there in front of you, and your mother did a good job of creating some sort of an appealing look.
Yeah.
When you drove up to it, it's like, oh, I'd like to go over there. I didn't know why.
Yeah.
And then I would go over, and when I went in, had sort of bustling.
Yeah.
You know, and that was really cool.
And it was a cool piece. Victor's has been there and since from the 80s. It was originally actually started by a gentleman named Victor who came over from Ireland with his family's roasting technique and coffee recipes. And actually started, had a little stand, a little drive-up stand. This was prior to, you know, drive-thrus being really popular out here. He was one of the first people to do that out here. And then finally was able to grow and build that space. And then my mom and at the time, her boyfriend took it over. But the aesthetic of Victor's is really cool because Redmond has changed so much. Redmond, back when I was a little kid and even before I was born, was just a sleepy old kind of almost farm town.
Yeah, yeah.
And as Microsoft came in and as more tech came into the surrounding area, Redmond really started to grow and become, you know, gain its identity. And you'll see pockets of Redmond where there's old buildings of old Redmond that were prior to this big boom. And that Victor's building is one of them. So it's a little piece of historic Redmond that's still there.
I hope it stays.
I do too. If you go down to Redmond now and see it, it's an entirely, it looks like Bellevue.
So now let me ask Macky a question.
Yes.
You went to Western Washington.
I did, yes.
And you met Matt at Western Washington?
I met Matt at Western Washington.
Tell us a little bit about that.
I'm 4 years older than Matt.
Good boy.
And we technically went to the same high school, though. When I graduated, I was in college. And when he started high school, he ended up going to college later on, too. So when I kind of found that connection. There was a little camaraderie with that. And at that time, I started my first entrepreneur business called Word of Mouth Productions. And what I basically did was gravitate college kids around liquor and alcohol.
So that's a very new idea.
And I got paid for it. So I met Matt and I found out
Let me interject a second. Word of mouth.
Yeah.
Just from curiosity. What was that?
I was a little bit early adopter, learning that a lot of business really truly grew based on people's recommendations. People they trustworthy, you know, people that they heard something from, and therefore they were willing to explore it or try a product.
Sure.
So I found out Matt had a filming company at the time, and he was only 19. But one way for me to sneak him into the bars illegally was legally I was able to have him come into and film some of the events that we did.
Nice.
At the time. So
and Matt, would you ever violate the law and maybe have a sip?
Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, I think that's how Macky convinced me because he wasn't paying me. So he said, yeah, I'll get you in the bar and we'll get you some drinks.
There we go. Then boom, bring the camera. I'm in.
Yeah.
That's why. Yeah. I got anytime you can get in for free someplace. Yeah.
So this adventure, word of mouth, great idea, fun, gave it a shot, but it didn't have legs.
No, it lasted for a good 5 years up at Western. So I stayed there post-graduation. You know, ended up looking for other companies to do sponsors, so working with some other brand recognition. But then you get a little old, you know, Bellingham's a really sleepy town. So then Seattle became like, what if I could do the same thing down there too, right? And so I ventured down to Seattle, but then you get to an age where it's like, this is the last thing you want to do at 28 years old.
What was the thing you're selling at Word of Mouth? How did money come in the door?
So basically bars paid me to hire music, whether I was, you know, I managed a band at the time. It was, you know, to do, you know, mostly holiday events and gravitate 300 to 800 to 1,000 kids, you know, who were 21 and up, obviously, to come and celebrate some kind of occasion.
So drive people to an event and they're paying you to get them there.
Yeah, I used to rent limos and Matt would have a bunch of people at his house. And one way to get all of his friends and people down to the bars were literally just pick them up in a bunch of limos and drive them straight there. So
damn. I'd have been all over that.
It was fun. For us, it was a lot about like getting college kids together to find something to do.
Mm-hmm.
And Macky was really, really good at helping provide that within the local infrastructure of the town. And we had a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun in college.
I saw the value in celebrations and getting people together. You know, I love just the networking aspect of it. I met a lot of people who owned a bunch of businesses in Bellingham. You know, it was like a tourist town that people came through when they were traveling music-wise to Canada and Seattle.
Yeah, it is. Now all of a sudden, let's talk Middle Fork.
Sure.
All of a sudden, you guys are hanging out. Forget the word of mouth. Get out of here, word of mouth.
Yeah.
And now, how does you two come together in Middle Fork?
Well, and kind of just taking one step back, and you say we did have a lot of fun, you know, going to bars and have all these events, but really what gravitated me towards Macky was his entrepreneurial spirit, and it was really, really contagious. we met because I had a little commercial company that me and my roommate were doing at the time, mostly just because we had video cameras and knew how to edit. Believe it or not, back then, that was a real special niche thing. I mean, now today with phones on a video on everyone's phones, it's not as niche. But we owned some cameras and stuff. And he showed me that you can take a passion and you can turn it into a business and you can work for yourself.
Yeah.
And that was really, it was a really contagious idea to me. And so that's what really gravitated me towards Macky was that he was doing this and that he was using his passions and creating a business around it.
Yeah.
So I graduated, got my marketing degree up there and came back down to the Redmond area. And as I was putting my resume out to go get a 9-to-5 and start my career, I was a broke college grad. And so I started working in my mom's cafe and kind of, like I was saying earlier, that was the moment where coffee really hit me.
Yeah.
I'd been around it, but I'd never worked it, and I'd never been around the atmosphere, really, that my mom had created.
What it creates, the culture creates around itself.
And I fell in love with it, really, within 2 weeks of being there. I absolutely fell in love with it, and actually began to appreciate the entrepreneur life my mom was living. Macky was the one that really made me believe in it, but then I realizing that this is what my mom's been doing, and
kind of opened your eyes to
it. Really did.
It really
changed. It was a big life-changing moment for me that I wanted to get into coffee. And so I approached my mom, I approached my dad. They're separated, but I was really lucky. My parents helped pay for my college, and so I felt that they had invested in me, and so I approached both of them and I said, I'd like to learn this industry. I know I got my marketing degree and I'd been talking about going and getting, a corporate job, but how do you guys feel about me learning the family business? And I'm extremely lucky that my parents are so supportive and in really anything I want. They said, we sent you to college to figure out what it is you want to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that was really, really special. So I started working at Victor's to learn the trade. My mom and her boyfriend owned it, and her boyfriend, Walter, is Swiss German, ex-military.
right down the line.
Right down the line. We used the story, kind of an older reference now, but Seinfeld, the soup Nazi.
Do you remember that episode?
He was the coffee Nazi, right? And so he ran a very, very tight ship, and because I was my mom's son, I absolutely was getting no special treatment. And so I started at the bottom, washing dishes and cleaning the bathroom, and basically working my way up to become a barista. Now, hindsight, what was really cool was what Walter, my mom's boyfriend, what he was doing was teaching me the business.
Sure, he's dragging you up through the bottom.
Absolutely. And now as a business owner, so many entrepreneurs want to get into a business because of all the fun, the sexy parts of it. But really, knowing the nitty gritty is really one of the keys of having a successful business. So he was really kind of starting to set that for me.
I find the same because in my business, which was bags, which is not exactly the most exciting thing in the world, but the only way to start it is to just pound it out on phone calls.
Yeah,
pound it out and call on small people.
Yeah.
And just start. So as you nibble your way up the ladder, as you get up a little further, where the value comes is that somebody comes in at the bottom and they start saying, I know how to do that. Or what we're doing. Oh, my God, I can't possibly do that. You're like, no, I did it.
Yeah, right.
I know that in my heart. I know what it is. It's not just something I think about.
Yeah.
I live that life. Yeah. And that helps a lot.
I started learning the trade and then eventually learning to become a roaster. I did my apprenticeship with my mom. And it was my eventual goal to fully retire them and buy this shop from them and take over the business. And Victor's is an extremely, extremely successful cafe. At the time, they were the only roaster on the east side that was roasting themselves. Yeah. It was very special, very niche. It's a lot more commonplace now, but back then it wasn't. And it was because of this, it was very successful and very expensive to purchase. So at this point, it's been probably 4 years since graduation, and while I am doing well, I'm still working on, barista and roasting wages. Yeah, I'm still living on my tips, and so I didn't have money to buy the business.
The capital wasn't there. We're going to get a little more fancy. There didn't have to be a good capital base.
Yeah.
Cash flow.
So I started. We were really lucky. Victor's being really close to Microsoft. We had a large Microsoft clientele, and just so happened at this time, there was this big kind of changing of the guard at Microsoft where there was a lot of newly retired people and customers that were looking to do something in their next phase of life. And so I was able to, through customers of the shop, put together 11 investors to buy Victor's with me.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah.
There's a lot in that.
And I had never done anything like that before. And I did it, and I was super proud. We had an investor meeting. Like, we were ready to sign the paperwork, and I got all these investors together, and I learned a really, really valuable lesson after this investor meeting. It's that 11 people involved in any one project, it's a pretty awful idea.
Where's the word clusterfuck comes to mind?
Yeah, that's to put it lightly how it turned out. We had this investor meeting, and it really went awful. We had people that wanted to go in all different directions, and it really... We disbanded after this meeting because we had no true vision on what it was going to be. And I was devastated. I was devastated that I had maybe made a bad decision in doing this. And so I went home that night and I just sent some good thoughts out to the universe that I just asked for guidance. And I went to bed. And the next morning at 5:30 in the morning, my phone rings. And it's my good buddy who knew the whole investor meeting had gone fallen through. And he's like, something told me to go on Craigslist, and I found something. And this little neighborhood down in South Seattle called South Park, which I had never heard of at
That's
the time.
That's a good name. I love that name. That's a good one.
And
steal that and make a show.
Yeah. And there was a warehouse down there with a coffee roaster in it, ready for a wholesale business. And I went down there, and I can't explain it other than the fact that I walked in, and I just knew. I knew this was it. This was my future. This was the direction. This was being presented to me for a reason.
I'm not a terribly religious guy.
Yeah.
I was raised Catholic, so there's some remnants of that in my mind, how things come out. But there's something out there that causes things in ways that don't make sense.
Yeah, and absolutely.
And they are twisty, turny things that every once in a while something goes down and you're like, wow, that's weird.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, sometimes it's weird and it's not good.
Right.
But the beautiful parts are when, and sometimes it's not work related.
Yeah.
A lot of times it's just in human interaction where there's something about it where it's magical.
Yeah.
Just for a second. And you're like, holy shit.
And that's absolutely the way it felt. And I felt like this was one of those seconds that I needed to take an opportunity with. So I met with the woman who was selling it. I came in and I told her my story and we really connected and I gave her an offer of what was in my bank account. And
$7.38.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't much over that.
Yeah, yeah. Every week for 10,000 weeks.
Yeah. And she took it. It was really awesome. She believed in me and wanted to give another entrepreneur. She was an entrepreneur as well. A head start and an opportunity to do something. And so, I wrote her a check. It was everything in my bank account. At home, I tell the story all the time. I have it framed at my house. It's my bank statement. It's 0.00 after I wrote this check. And
we're starting again.
Yeah.
Well, the best part, there was no brand and no name at the time.
No, nothing. I spent everything just to get this warehouse, and I had no accounts. I had nothing. And I called my mom and her boyfriend, Walter, up in Florida. Can you guys come back up and run Victor's so that I can go chase this crazy idea? And they did. They took a flight like the next day, came back up to go back and run the business to let me chase my dream.
Wow, that's really cool.
That is really special. Cool. And my mom's been always a huge, huge supporter in everything that I wanted to do.
What a wonderful commitment to have in your life.
Real special.
Somebody cares for you.
Yeah.
Somebody cares for you deeply.
It's really awesome that they would do that for me. And so they came back up and I had 30 days to come up with the rent for the building, let alone my cell phone bill and my health insurance and my car payment. And so I knew I had to do something fast. And so a good buddy of mine, Nigel, was a photographer. And so him and I taught ourselves Photoshop off of YouTube.
Right.
And
on.
We developed the brand. We named it Middle Fork Roasters. The Middle Fork of the Snoqualmie is a place I've been going out to since I was a little kid. My dad taught me how to fish
out
there.
Is that what it is, Middle Fork?
Yeah,
to me, it was just a funky name. Well,
yeah.
I'm not from here, so it's like Middle Fork.
Yeah, it's the middle. The Snoqualmie splits into three forks. You got the North Fork, the South Fork, and the Middle Fork. The Middle Fork is just kind of a little bit north of North Bend. And it's a spot that I've been going out to for a long time. In fact, when I named the company, my buddy, who's the one who founded on Craigslist, we went out there to get inspiration because we could not figure out what we were going to work. What are we going to call this thing? We came up with the blends. We came up with some of the imagery, but we still had no idea what we were going to call it. And so he grabbed me. He's like, let's go fishing. Let's get out in nature. Let's clear our minds. And the name will come to us.
So now we're getting up to meeting Macky?
Yeah. Well, so we were out there and then we decided to name it Middle Fork after being out there. And, then we launched the company. We came up with the branding. Whole Foods was our very first account.
Whole Foods?
Yeah.
Well, that was smaller back then.
Yeah. They were...
The Bellevue store.
They still had a pretty big footprint out here. I mean, mm-hmm. It was a big retail chain.
So it was a hot deal that you got.
Absolutely. Now we're getting to where Macky comes in about 3 months, 4 months into the business. I'm just started. And this whole time, I wanted to get Macky to come see what I had done. Selfishly, I was hoping that I could get Macky to come on board and help me.
But he was running IBM at the time?
I figured Macky was probably running 4 or 5 businesses. It had really been years since I talked to him, so I started putting out feelers just through our friends. Eventually, it did. We were able to connect, and Macky, you can kind of tell how we were able to reconnect.
Bring it on, Macky. Yeah. Let's hear it.
I got to backtrack to college a little bit. I kind of learned early that, you know, I was literally 21 at Black Angus, if anybody remembers those restaurants back in the days.
Yeah, I remember Black Angus.
I was actually 20, snuck in before I was 21, and my buddy Kelly was serving, you know, beer at the bar, and some old man came up to me and took his finger and just poked me right in the temple. And I was like, what are you doing, you know? And he...
Like right over here.
Oh, just right in the temple. Just really just nailed it right in there. And I looked at him. He had a nice suit, nice watch, nice shoes. And he goes, you know what you got in there, kid? And I'm like, a brain? And he goes, you know what you're going to do with that brain? You're going to do one or two things. He goes, you're either going to sell your own labor and work for somebody else for the rest of your life, or you're going to sell your own thoughts and ideas and work for yourself. And I can't tell you why, when I went to bed that night, for 2 weeks, that's all I thought about. You know, the guy just like poofs, like never saw him again. But for some reason, I just knew then that was something inside of me that I knew was going to be my end result, no matter
which path.
Maybe
he didn't exist.
Yeah. That's true.
I might have had a psychotic break for a moment, and now who cares? Get you in the right direction.
Right. So I just fast forward, Ryan, our friend Ryan, who found the business on Craigslist for Matt. I happened to, at this time in my life, no, I wasn't running IBM. No, I wasn't running a ton of businesses at the time. I actually got engaged to my college sweetheart.
Okay.
Bought a house up in Snoqualmie Ridge.
Okay.
And when I asked for her hand in marriage to her parents, which was the proper thing to do, I had this very long meeting with her father.
Ooh.
And her father said, you know, I will grant you permission to marry my daughter if you work for a job that has a 401k and health insurance. So reluctantly, I didn't have any boundaries at that time. I was definitely a yes person. Anybody asked, requested anything of me, I just showed up and did it, right? So at that time, I ended up, you know, looking for, you know, work, and I ended up landing a job at my friend's dad's company, which was called Orthotech. And it was, they make retainers and night guards for local orthodontists.
Right,
so
that's cool. That's
I literally was just driving and delivering product, and I got to do a little bit of sales at the same time. At the time, was I happy at all whatsoever? I was totally miserable.
But you're getting, you're doing.
But
what
I was
said.
Getting what I thought was getting done to, you know, make appease, you know, her parents, right, which would have been my future parents-in-law. So at the time, we're still engaged, and I'm at this type 1 diabetes camp, and it was just kind of the 2008, 2009 before Matt, you know, founded Middle Fork at the time and walked into that warehouse, and a lot of things in my life just, you know, gravity just took full force, and I landed, you know, straight flat in my face.
Hmm. That sucks. If anybody out there is listening, if that happens, you're not alone. Yeah. Very few people that are have done anything on their own, and even in big companies.
Yeah,
there's huge setbacks, huge, and we got to, you know, you just got to find a way to get over them. Yeah. But they do hurt.
Oh, for sure.
When you hit,
no,
they hurt, you know?
Absolutely.
So I now mean, you're it, on the ground flat. You're like a, yeah, car, you're mean, like a cartoon.
Yeah, yeah, my cardiac arrest kind of flat. Like, not to be too sappy in the details of that aspect. But, you know, some of those things, again, like remembering the book Failing Forward, you know, by John Maxwell, right? And And, you know, it was like getting back up. You know, I didn't want to. For me, it was like a total catastrophe.
Yeah.
And 10 months later, I had to call off that engagement. The right thing to do, you know.
Okay.
I knew in my heart that it wasn't where my future kind of lied, so to speak. And when it was literally the night before I called off my engagement, you know, I was very graceful about it and told her, you know, we need to move on with our lives. I didn't know what to do that night. I was just like, what am I going to do with my life? Well, the very next day, I ran into Ryan, and I found out this whole time his dad worked for Medtronic. They make insulin pumps.
Yeah. They're in a whole bunch of stuff now.
All kinds
of
stuff.
Well, they do all kinds of medical
Yeah, because I know the name all over the
defibrillators
place.
Defibrillators and everything.
I remember in our conversation, Macky's volunteering at a type 1 diabetic camp, and my dad was head of the diabetics division.
Yeah. So lo and behold, you know, can you call your dad, do a favor? And he called, and within 2 weeks, I got boxes full of just goodies and gifts to the kids.
Cool.
Because at camp, you do obnoxious things. Yeah. Since I had all my third graders make all these thank you gifts to Matt and his father.
Oh,
and it was
cool.
Birdhouses and, you know, all these stuff and crafts. And I was the type of person that wanted to meet Matt's dad in person and shake his hand, right?
Uh-huh.
But when you move into a house, the first thing you do is just have a bunch of housewarming parties.
Yeah, yeah.
But for some reason, I woke up that morning and I had literally had to start my new life. I opened my closet door in my kitchen and this big envelope sitting there. And I needed to do something constructive. I was mostly sitting there for 10 months, pissing on myself in the corner, feeling sorry for myself.
Yeah, pouting.
And I needed to do something, you know, what I felt of value. So that's when I pulled up. Ryan was outside and he came up to my car. He said, Matt's been looking for you. And I said, that's crazy. I have something I need to give to him and his father. And I would love to connect with him. Well, at the time, Matt lost his cell phone number, as per usual.
Per usual.
We have a ton of insurance on everything, by the way. He breaks everything.
He's in the dark. We can't find him. He's been ghosted.
Yeah.
100% of the time. Yeah.
He doesn't even know, but he no longer exists out there.
So, you know, I give him a call and he's just excited. I'm hearing like excitement. I'm hearing passion. I'm starting to feel good.
Yeah.
You know, because most of the time I was just literally self-reflecting myself in my depression.
Yeah.
And so I called him up and he goes, what are you doing? And I said, well, I'm going to head up to Bellingham to ski to see weekend to go visit a friend. This was Memorial weekend. And he goes, can you drive up? I was at 30 pounds of coffee to Risex, which was one of his first accounts. And I said, sure, I'm headed up there anyway. Let's meet in Bellevue on my way up to, you know, up to Bellingham. Lo and behold, at the time, Matt knew nothing about my personal life, you know. And I didn't make it a real public thing, you know.
Sure.
At the time, you kind of keep a lot of those things really private. And so we met in Bellevue right next to Whole Foods. And he was just, this guy was on fire. I can't tell you this, you know, the story he gave you was a very, you know, dull version of the details of what really took place and how it came to fruition,
sure.
Which was all really exciting. And at the very end, he goes, hey, I don't know what you're doing in your life right now, but if there's, you know, you taught us all these things in college and we learned this, and he was, you know, regurgitating all these old quotes I used to use. And he goes, if there's any part of this business, if you want to be a part of it, I want you to know it's here. It's offered to you right here, right now.
Okay, now this is Matt making that comment
offered
to you.
Offered to me. Yeah.
So now let's snap ahead a little bit.
Sure.
Now you guys have met.
Yeah.
Right. And now, if we were to go there to say Middle Fork has a customer and you come on, and now what happens? What did you said you said earlier that you felt as though he's sort of the entrepreneurial thing that was going on. So you bring, I know your energy. I've met you many times in my life. It's beautiful. And so now you come into the game and Middle Fork is sitting here, you know, tiny, big. I just have a little tiny circle I'm making for the listeners, and it's going to become a big one. So, or a bigger one. And the thing that always had me, which I admired, and which will follow on to the question that I have, or the thing I want to look into, is I've always been fascinated that you've been able to survive as a smaller roaster in a community out here. And anybody listening knows, just by word of whatever, by whoever, it's Seattle is a huge coffee market. And there's a lot of people coming and going and squeezing people out, pushing people out, you know, trying to smack them around. The two of you got together and somehow found the hole that worked. And I guess to what extent that would be, I mean, not that you did all of it, but your entrepreneurial spirit, I guess, sort of found that spot.
Yeah, yeah.
And how would you, between the two of you, how did you expect? So now we got the Whole Foods, and now we have somebody, 30-pound guy up in Bellingham.
Yeah.
But now if we jump ahead a little, what are the next few steps, the next couple of years? What happens that maybe turns the switch up a little bit?
Yeah, I'll start and you don't let you chime in too. I would say, you know, I when Matt made that moment, that offer, you know, and I walked into that warehouse, you know, saw what he was up to, what he wanted to do. The truth is, at the time, I never even drank a cup of coffee. My mom told me if I drink a cup of coffee, I would shrink.
Oh,
she's Filipino, right? And so we're not super tall people. And I believe that to be true. And of course, Matt grabs me by the shoulder and says, I'm 6'4". I've been drinking coffee since I was 10, right?
Well, yeah, but you could have been 6'8". Sure.
So I said, you know, at the end of the day, like, you know, our work ethic, us to outwork, you know, the people out in this industry who've been here since, you know, the 50s, so to speak, was what it was going to take. And so for us, I mean, we did some unconventional things.
Yep.
At a time where, you know, I might have been working at my other job, but also delivering coffee at the same time, getting paid to do that, you know, because I had the vehicle. Matt had a Durango with a broken window.
The broken window is always nice. It's a good idea. Very classy. It's a good way to get customers.
I remember our conversation. It came down to whether we buy our next round of beans or fix the car window.
Always going to the beans.
Give me the beans.
We were pitching people like Lions Club members in Poles Bowl. We were doing whatever it took to get the name out, the brand out. We sat at one time at Matthew's Thriftway up in Lakemont.
Yep.
And this guy, I mean, some of the grocery managers back in these days were, you know, all named Steve, and they all worked from 4 a.m. in the morning to about 2 o'clock. And if you pitched them around 11 o'clock, they were pretty grumpy
done for the day,
you know. But it was one of those like where we, you know, whatever it took, right? And then he didn't want to give us the time of the day. Obviously, he didn't know who we were, and we sat there probably for an hour and a half, just sitting out front in the chair he told us to sit down until he came back, right?
Yeah, outside his office.
But it was one of those things that he said, "Wow, you guys are pretty serious, right?" And gave us that opportunity. You know, it was those kind of things. You know, having other jobs, working. You know, being the last, you know, first one up when you leave your house, last one to show up in your neighborhood, you know, and do that over and over again for 2 years.
You know what I would read again. I always hated when I was young, having sold. I always hated the "you're going to be a millionaire." It didn't resonate with me. It just didn't. "You're going to go out," and just kind of pissed me off, actually. But there was something very practical.
Yeah.
And one was, if you want to interact with decision makers, get them before 8 a.m., 8 a.m., or after 5.
Sure.
That's when you get them,
because
they're calmed down.
Sure. Yeah.
So I heard that. So I started setting my meetings. It was the middle of the winter in Philly. It's cold, bitter cold. I start setting my sales calls up at 6:30 a.m. with these guys, or 7. And then the guy says, "Always show up 15 minutes early." So I remember, and I was like, I can't tell you, maybe 25% of the bastards never showed up.
Yeah.
So I just sit out there and freeze my ass off till like 9, and finally shows up, and it's like, I'm too busy, you know, and you're like, damn. But some of the ones that I got, they really appreciate it, you know, but that's similar to you. You know, sometimes you just got to, if you want to have your own business or do something as an entrepreneur, some of it's just, hey, you're new. You just got to sit and wait and be determined as hell.
Determination for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, 100%.
Just sit there and take it. You're going to be punched around. People aren't going to give you respect. Yeah. So what do you got to do? Go sit in a chair outside Thriftway and shut up.
Yeah.
So now we're out of the chair.
We went heavy grocery. And for us, it was like, give us a shot. And if anything you don't sell, we'll buy it all back. And we'll do it within 30 days. Because we put a roasted on date on the front, which nobody was doing at the time. And that was a kind of a big
wait. So you put it in there and you'll buy it back?
Yep.
In case it didn't sell. But the reason it sold is because we spent our entire nights and weekends doing demos for the first 2 years of our business, including farmers markets in the summer. That's all we did. Tunnel vision, no life, no dating. It was all or nothing.
And farmers markets, that's hard work.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. But one thing we realized early, and Macky, kind of going back to his word of mouth, it kind of fits into word of mouth, is relationships. And people, whether it's like becoming friends with people or buying a product, people are on a relationship with something, and they want to be able to hear a story and understand what this product is. And so Macky and I spent a lot of time. It was a driving force of our business was to tell our story and build relationships with the people that drink our coffee. And so we would go post up in a Whole Foods for 6 hours and as the owners, hand out cups of coffee to every person that walked by and tell our story and let people know what we were doing.
Passion. That's the side of what makes somebody like you guys selling coffee in a very competitive market.
Yeah.
And to some extent, like me selling bags.
Yeah.
You know, if you're not just fired up.
Yeah.
And you know, it so happens that you two got together fired up about this thing, coffee.
Yeah.
But then it transcends that.
Yeah.
It becomes, you know, something that you passionately want to get to people.
Yep.
And you believe it. And now you're
And that passion's contagious with people.
Yeah, it is. People, it is. People love seeing it, that. They love it.
And they gravitate towards it. And really, it was as simple as that. It was getting out there, pounding the pavement, introducing ourselves to people, and putting our product in people's hands.
We did the win the store, win the shelf. We would do 5 a.m., feed the staff of Whole Foods before the store opened, giving away baseball T-shirts. We made baby onesies for women who were pregnant and couldn't drink coffee. You know what I mean? And we didn't have money at the time. We didn't have any money. But we knew that they were around the shelf so much. And if somebody asked, inquiring about coffee, like, it was guaranteed for them to use our, they were going to drop our name.
Yeah.
And we knew that.
So you went grocery right down the line.
Right off the bat.
Grocery. Interesting.
Well, it was almost out of necessity. We were a two-man show. We had no distribution. We had a Durango with a broken window.
It's okay.
And
it's okay.
Friends and family volunteering.
We don't have to say the Durango again. We know it doesn't have a window. We're going to work on that. Okay, listen, we're going to work on that.
We found that grocery was really one of those markets that could support a company like ours and give us the resources to grow. They would do all of our marketing. They gave us the access to the customer base. You know, they would promote us. They would allow us to give us the physical space to show up and present our coffee to customers.
So now in this world that you're going, is there a point within that that you kind of, well, there's a sense where you go, oh, it starts to become, now it's a business. It can survive.
Yep.
So what stage do you think you transitioned into something, and what would have made that transition happen? But before you say, how many years out would you finally said, okay, I think I kind of got this thing flowing?
I mean, I definitely felt like year two, we felt like we had something. We weren't there yet, but with the way we were growing, the response we were getting, the inquiries that were constantly coming in, we felt like we were on track. I'd say year three and year four is really where we sat back, and it was that, you know, that holy shit moment. Here we go. We had expanded the warehouse. Yeah. We had taken on another 7,000 square feet just to keep
up.
Wow,
that's a lot of space for a small business.
With production. So I say year three, year four was really, we started hiring people, paying employees.
Oh boy.
And then it really felt like,
just say you're going to pay it, or did you actually give them a check?
No, we give them a check.
And the check didn't bounce?
No,
I know.
In fact, I think there's only one check my maintenance guy will never let me live the story down. From our repair guy. But I think that's the only check in the history of Middle Fork
That's one thing in business. If you're lucky, and you're able to make some money. Some people don't pay their employees because they got no money.
Yeah.
And it's the real deal. But if pay your people.
Yeah. Well,
you pay them on time. Get them the damn money right on time.
100%.
You know, and I know with our, because I'm a salesman, but don't squabble over commissions.
Yeah.
Dude, now unless they're lying or cheating, but I mean, dude made some money or gal made some money, get her a damn commission.
Yeah.
And let's get this game going.
I want to pinpoint a little more for me. Mm-hmm. I would say we started to diversify our portfolio. You know, we did a little bit more of the retail restaurant stuff, mm-hmm. and then we met one of the guys who sold Seattle's Best. Just randomly came in, kind of heard about us, and was just seeing what we were up to, and gave us a really good advice to just, you know, expand that portfolio to not just have one funnel, because he knew at the time it was just grocery. We started getting an office coffee, working with some office coffee suppliers here. And if you wanted to get into some of these big Fortune 500 companies, you had to sell through them through the catalog. They had the contracts.
Yeah.
I remember Matt and I were out at Google campus in Kirkland, and we were competing against the best of the best. Terra Fazioni, Stumptown, Vita. And when we did our demo there, like, we won that contract.
Wow.
And it started really small, like in just a part of the building in the break room. But then as we did more demos, they did yearly competitions, we started to win them, you know, multiple times. Yeah.
So we won it. Now, I just love hearing about business. You know, if somebody doesn't like hearing about small businesses right now, you're probably turning this thing off. But, you know, anyway, but now you won that deal against, for anybody who doesn't know, the Seattle area, Cafe Vita, Torre Frazioni. I mean, these are the players, Stumptown. These are big guys. You know, you're so somehow you win that.
Yeah, we duplicated it, and we went to Valve Software, Paul Allen Institute.
Yep.
You know, we started looking, you know, you kind of look at that portfolio and you look at the names on that list, and it was like, wow, we're in some of the most successful, you know, businesses here, you know, here in Washington. So for me, I would say that when I knew that we were on that level playing field, mm-hmm. that people were picking us,
yeah.
you know, and choosing us, you know, quality, hopefully relationship, you know, more driven kind of things and, mm-hmm. you know, getting to know the people behind the business. And maybe they weren't sending, you know, their owners like, you know, us, but we were putting all that face time in and it was always worth
yeah.
all of it.
Yeah, so. Now you start, if you're running a business, you know, you get into, I don't particularly care to get into this subject because I think it's a little bit drab when you talk about business, but you do start getting into, now you have to watch cash flow. Now you have to be keeping an eye on your inventory. You have yep. to, you know, it gains a complexity that is something that mm-hmm. is very real. If you don't have a sense for, I always say cash flow, that can really screw you up if you get your cash flow out of whack.
Absolutely.
I mean, it can put you down. You know, and you can be a pretty good company, and now you just came into, anybody doesn't know what cash flow means, you know, a bill comes in, and you have a bunch of people who are supposed to give you money, mm-hmm. not, but they're not giving the money for another 25 days, but somebody asked for the money today.
Oh, and
you owe it to them.
Yeah, most of our stuff's set up net 60, net 90, so yeah. cash flow is very important to us.
It's a huge thing, you know? Yeah, I mean, it is, and it was to us, too. And if anybody wants to learn about cash flow, there's a lot of books on it. Go read them. I'm not going to go through it here.
Well, and to piggyback on that, cash flow is of the utmost importance to us. We operate with zero debt, so yeah. we do not borrow money to operate our business. We never have. I mean, I'm not saying we never will, but up until this point here, now 14 years into business, we've done it all off of cash.
And well, that's good. You're lucky. You're lucky. A lot of people.
Yeah, we use cash to buy the granola business a couple doors down from us, right?
Yeah.
So now when you said, Macky, that you're up and kicking, yeah. you know, you're kind of like, now you got these bigger accounts going. Well, what's the next phase? You know, when do you think, in your mind, did you supersize a little bit? You know, you puff it up some and go, wow, now I have a more developed going concern. Was there something that you did within the business that created that?
Yeah, you know, one of the things that we've always joked around about is that coffee's such a great industry to be in. It's actually the second highest consumed commodity under petroleum. So oil and then coffee. A lot of people don't realize
that. I've heard that many times. It's pretty cool.
It's pretty wild how much the consumption is out there for this beverage. And so one of our jokes was that, like, for sales, our target was we could close our eyes, spin in a circle, and you point at a building and there's coffee in there.
Yeah.
and so really for, I would say year 3 to year 11 was just generating business through more grocery, through more campuses, through more, like, any small business. They have a break room. They're selling coffee.
So were you selling bulk, some 5-pound bags?
Yeah. We're selling a majority bulk. That was all. The campus was all done in bulk bags.
I'm going to break in here for a second.
Yeah.
Anybody out there who knows the coffee business, what coffee moves the vast majority of, actually the tonnage, probably, and correct me if I'm wrong, moves through what is called a 5-pound bag. 5 pounds of product to get to a store, to get to a cafe, yeah. to get places. 5-pound bags. And what we refer to that as bulk.
Mm-hmm.
So continue.
Yeah, yeah. And so we started really ramping up a lot of our bulk. And then just through our name growing, our presence growing here within the coffee market in Seattle, kind of the third pillar of our business started to form, which was cafes. And even though roasting, the technology of roasting has got more accessible to cafes, and you do see now a lot more cafes roasting for themselves, this still huge, vast majority of entrepreneurs that are starting cafes are outsourcing their coffee to a roaster like ourselves. And so we started developing a program for that.
Okay.
It's not quite as simple as grocery or corporate campuses where it's more transaction and we're selling coffee and then it gets shipped to them. This is more of a service where we're supporting the cafe. We're helping with menu development. We're helping with barista training. As far as, like, just entrepreneurial 101 for a lot of these businesses. One of our big things is that we love to work with new startup people, that this is their first time, you know, starting a business and becoming an entrepreneur. And
so they're all pumped up.
And they're all pumped up. And we've been, like we like to say all the time, we've been there. We've been a startup. We've been a struggling business. And we've learned a lot along the way. And we love to pass on that information.
Sure, sure. Now, in the small cafe, I'm always intrigued by that. And because There is a relatively high failure rate in that. Is that a fair statement to say?
Sure.
With all small business, absolutely.
Yeah, but I mean in the cafe world, because it seems like it's just it seems to me if you plop a cafe into somewhere and you're brand new, that you got a lot of expense piled on there. You know, when you get your lease going and you get this, that.
Well, and that's...
You got to pull customers.
And that's a lot of mistakes new entrepreneurs make, is that they, when they come in, they start a new business, they sign a terrible lease. They don't know how to do, you know, proper hiring. They don't know how to do proper sourcing with a cafe selling a lot more than coffee with their pastries and all these things.
Yeah.
And, you know, it is a business at the end of the day, and there are things, margins, and, you know... A lot of people that start a new business kind of like fall in love with it, like myself, because they went to a cafe and they get into it and they don't quite realize a lot of those other aspects of it. And so that's a big piece that Macky and I try to value add, that we try to add to a lot of our customers, is show them the things that we've learned and the things that make a successful business.
Yeah. Give them warning signs, flashing yellows.
Beyond nostalgia. Yeah.
Yeah.
They love coffee and they're passionate about coffee, but there's the business, there's operating expenses, there's labor costs, right?
Yeah,
it's so much more than the glorious, you know, latte art.
It's the nitty gritty.
Right.
But they say that the worst person to start a restaurant is a chef. I've read that once, because they fall in love with their meals, their cooking, and they don't realize, you know,
they're
critical things, you know, portion control. You can't just be piling it on. You know what I mean? You got to be ready to move your product profitably.
The number one advice we give to entrepreneurs, notoriously, is the market speaks to those who listen.
Yeah.
And if anybody understands what that means, you have to remove yourself and your selfish ideas and the things you want to push and shove down their throat. And the market's going to tell you to move and shift towards what the demand is.
Macky and Matt have more recently started something that I don't want to get chit-chatting about unless you want to chit-chat about. We can just spike it. But are you feeling comfortable talking about what you see as a new idea in your world, a new potential business opportunity? Because what little you said to me, I like it. I like the idea.
Yeah, we recently took some of the cash flow and took over an existing business. It was another turnkey operation.
Okay.
We also know wholesale really well.
Oh.
So we saw an opportunity on a product. We were doing some fine ground full city espresso with one of the products, so we were familiar with it for a pretty long time. Right now, granola is a trend. It's trending up. Overnight oats is trending up. And we thought, you know, we had the capability to duplicate a lot of the formulas that we do for this business and make it successful for a product that we're not as familiar with, but are willing to, you know, take the chance on that.
And you, what do you think about it?
I'm presuming you agree.
With more smarts this time around.
That's really true. It's an exciting venture. It's a product we love. They've been a neighbor of ours in our building for 10 years or so.
Clarify the product exactly.
Oh yeah, sorry. It's called Marge Granola.
Okay.
It's a little bakery two doors down from us in our business park. How it landed in our lap, the head baker over there actually came over looking for a job, and we were really confused. We said, oh, you're leaving. And he said, no, Joe, who was the owner, is closing it down. And both Macky and I kind of are the entrepreneurial kind of spark started going.
Yeah, like
we love the product. It's absolutely, the twisting of the mustache. Yeah.
I was going to say, originally I called Brad, the owner of Homegrown, and he was buying up Molly sandwiches. He just bought Catapult Northwest. He was buying all these companies. So I thought it would just be an additional thing that he wanted to do for his next venture. And then we said, wait, why aren't we taking an opportunity to look at it? We could be Brad too.
And so we looked at the books. It was operating.
I don't like Brad, by the way. I just want to let you know. Let's go get Brad, guys. No, Brad, I hear he's a good guy.
Yeah, it was operating at a loss and needed some help. It just kind of needed some new juice to flow through it. And both Macky and I, with our experience, our experience in distribution, our connections with grocery, we feel like it's a great grocery product. It was just, again, one of those opportunities that we said, hey, let's give it a shot. We both believe in it. I mean, as much as we talk about business and all the keys to success that we do as owners, the quality of the product and what you're serving is so extremely important.
Yeah,
and we found that with the granola. It was just we felt it was something special, and we took it on, and we bought it in October 1st. Of last year. So we're 6 months.
You're just babes in the woods, right?
Brand new, and it's been a lot of fun. It hasn't been without its challenges. 4 months into the business, there's a nationwide oat shortage, which is the number one ingredient in granola. So
anymore.
Yeah, there's been some logistical challenges of growing it, but it's been fun. It's fun going back. It's almost a little nostalgic going back, and we've been with Middle Fork and having a real big successful business that's turned into. It's been fun to kind of go back to the beginning and
relive. We got to credit. So Megan, who founded it, it's her grandmother Marge's recipes.
Yeah, okay.
So they're like some of the best granola people say they've ever had. To Joe, who came in and bought it, did a great job operationally in the books. So the books were pretty much super clean.
They're pretty clean.
The problem is, like any entrepreneur coming in and taking a business, a lot of times it's like open mouth, open business, closed mouth, closed business. They were very closed mouths about the opportunity to continue to, and that's what happens when you're in business. You're working so much inside the place, inside the building, you're not working on the business from the outside. And so we realized that as we've grown a little bit wiser and smarter, we can apply a lot of, we've made plenty of mistakes along the way. That's why you and I were talking before we walked in here about a co-packer, right? Like we could maybe get to that place, where we could use a lot more of our marketing and sales aspects and let somebody else do the kind of the hard labor production aspects of those things too. So, there's a lot of ideas we can do with that product and partner with a couple other companies to,
I think, just when I hear it, it gets my juices flowing. You think you're ready to some extent, sort of step out of the game. But the problem is if you get close to the game, you want to be in the game.
Yep.
And you can't be halfway in. Mm-hmm. You're either in or you're out.
Yeah.
And that's what I've learned in the last few years. But let's go back. One of the big things that I like to try and touch on is because I'm intrigued by just people, what drives them, and, really just curious. Why are you doing this?
I love people. I love being around people. I love meeting new people. I was just thinking as you asked that question, there's this like 19-year-old, her name's Natasha.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a great referral for a lot of our business outside of Washington State, cafe-wise. And she, it really wants to, her dream is to open up a cafe. And she sent me, I said, why don't you send me your executive summary? When I read this thing, I'm like, this is what a 40-year-old would write. Then I said, send me your business plan. And I read that, and I was like, this is what a 50-year-old would look like. And she has this, like, honed energy called Cobblestone Alley. I just know when I see something, it's going to come to fruition. She's going to do it in Coconut Grove, likely Florida. And she lives in Laguna Beach in California. And she's temporarily going to be moving to Montana. But as you spit and spend some time, with the questions they ask, because they're so young, and it's fun to mentor.
Sure.
There's something of value you can create through our life experiences of what we've done. And just, it's that give back, whether we get the account as to be the roaster or not, that's who's to say that. But the dialogue alone for me, and the response and the authenticity with it, it's like you get to a point in business and in life, like you have to stand for people,
Yeah.
You have to stand for their possibilities. Like we wrote our check on our possibilities with, the ridiculous amount of sacrifices we made to get there. 99% of them aren't even heard on this podcast right now, But we, when you believe in that and you, for humanity as a whole, that's really what it's about for me. It's about community. Matt and I didn't throw an anti-human trafficking auction in the middle of South Park, a very heavy area of trafficking, in the middle of a day on a weekend, where you as a company supported us, because we thought we were going to make the biggest change and difference in the world, but it was like threading the needle a little bit.
Sure.
The money we raised that day had nothing in comparison to the money that people make off human beings,
The why is ultimately, because I do think some of those things you're doing are cool, by the way. I don't want to override that. But really the why for you would be that you just enjoy interacting with people and bringing things together with human beings.
Yeah, cultivate community somehow, some way with the where we live geographically, the people we interact with.
And you, Matt, where were we with you?
The why for me is really simple. It's I love it. I feel like life is so short, and I started this business when I was 27. I'm 40 now. That it really feels like yesterday, and you've seen 13 years just snap away like that. And so with life being so short and how crazy the world is and always has been, that it's important to do things that make you happy. And one of the most important things in your life, I think, is finding work that is happy. It takes up the largest chunk of our time day to day. We spend, you know, the vast majority of our young life working. And so doing something that you love, I think, is so, so important. And, you know, to anyone listening out there, that doesn't necessarily mean working for yourself or being an entrepreneur, but just wherever you do work or whatever you decide to do, is do something you love. I mean, that's ultimate. That's the quickest way to ultimate happiness. And I found that. I found really good peace and happiness in my life. And it's because of that. It's because I've chosen to do what I want to do and what I love. And so that's the why for me. It's just the happiness aspect.
I just think that's cool, because I think the different pieces of you come to me. I would add another one, but the show isn't about where my why.
Well, what is your why?
What was my why? I think my why is from when I was a younger kid. I was raised in a way that it was a demanding. Get out there and be a something.
Mm-hmm.
Excel. And typically it would be through school. Do well in school.
Yep.
Go out there, you know, and bust chops. My dad had his own business. Normally in more our world, it was driven towards small business type operations. I was not the one who got great grades. I was not the one who was excelling. And when I finally got through my troubles, you know, when if anybody who knows me, you know, I got into problems with alcohol, I get into problems with drugs, I got done all that. And when I came out, I was hell-bent on proving that I could be good. And I didn't care what it was. I think at that time, if you told me to sell, you know, paper, I would prove to you I'm good at paper. Well, I sold bags pretty damn close to paper.
Right.
But I wanted something. And I think what happened is that I started to get such a passion that it became a place where it wasn't a job anymore. I loved it.
Yep.
And so much of what you said, I'm a people person. Once I started selling and could get in front of people and interact with them, I felt like I knew I think I could make them like me, and I think that I could make them want to buy from me, and I knew I wouldn't screw them.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't out to screw them.
Truth.
I'd feel bad if I did, and I'd get your damn money back.
Yeah.
And I think if you do that, I think there's success out there. So now that everybody's found out why I'm happy, I just wanted to thank Macky McNish, Matt Parrish from Middle Fork Roasters for coming out here today.
Thank you, Mark.
And,
thanks, Mark.
I'm glad we were here. I had fun. I learned something about you too that you never know until you sit down and just bump around a little bit. But so that's about all. Thank you for everybody listening. See you later. Bye-bye. Thanks for tuning in to the Mark Halley Show. Hope you'll join us again. Adios.